Just let's not quick... use slurs on this podcast, eh?
No. Real estate agents are people too.
Sometimes. You ever looked at a guy you went to school with who became a real estate agent and gone, man, I wish I kept up with them?
No. You know what the best thing to hear from a real estate agent is?
What's that?
Congratulations, you set the building record.
Yeah. That's when you know you've paid the right price.
That's when you know. You walk around with a scent of wobbly head though. People park in the visitors parks, I'm just going to park them in.
You got to extricate your iPhone 13 Max, Pro Max from the skinniest, tightest chino that's known to man.
Yeah.
Hello, Tarot Cash Central.
You've confused me. I don't shop at Roger David. Anyway, we're talking off air.
We were. We do that
Pokemon
sometimes.
Versus Digimon theme songs.
Yeah. Oh, there's a clear winner.
And it's not even a conversation. It's not even a discussion.
Absolutely not.
Because Digimon is so far above Pokemon theme song.
Unbelievable. Like, next level.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
I think Digimon, the only other one I can think of that it's rivaled by is Yu-Gi-Oh.
Oh, it's pretty good.
It is.
Your move!
I remember, you know when you'd have like the Windows visualizer?
Yeah. Yeah.
I had, for some reason, when I was like 8... 4 Yu-Gi-Oh songs.
What? Is there 4 Yu-Gi-Oh songs? Or is it the same song 4 times?
I have only ever heard one. I don't know where the other 3 came from. But they were sung by like characters and stuff. Don't ask me where it came from. I think it was like a disc in a cereal box.
Oh, probably like a Nutri-Grain?
Or like a K-Zone magazine. But it was sick. I just sit there as an 8-year-old watching the visualizers like this.
And that's why he's good at maths today.
Maths?
Maths. While we're on the topic of Digimon, before we get into the rest of the pod.
The goated
with the
digital
source.
Cartoon monster
that,
TV
thank you,
show.
Yes, yeah. I want to run by you the Digimon movie soundtrack.
Oh.
It is incredible.
So, can we just say,
yeah,
I have a playlist on my phone called All Time. No, my all-time favorite songs.
No, I got that. That makes sense.
But I shit you not.
Show the audience. I've got to show. Awesome.
I shit you not.
For listeners at home, that is the Digimon movie.
That's a focus, you fuck.
That is the Digimon movie poster.
It's the Digimon movie soundtrack CD artwork. Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome.
Because it is a goated soundtrack.
It's so good.
If I ever find that on vinyl,
oh,
I will pay a ridiculous amount of money for that. So
vinyl
shops in Australia. I'll fly to Japan. I'll fly to the... No, I probably won't fly that far. If there are any vinyl shops in Australia with the Digimon movie vinyl...
There is a Reddit thread. There's a Reddit thread from 8 years ago that is petitioning to get the Digimon movie soundtrack pressed on vinyl.
So it hasn't happened.
Well, hang on. I'm just looking. No, it hasn't.
It'll probably cost like $400.
You can buy this CD for $99 on Amazon. But let's tell the listeners what they're missing out on by not saying.
No, I agree. Because, I mean, can we just say it's a great movie too?
Oh, it's a belter. It's also so like good. 4 movies in one.
Oh, yeah. It's got stages.
Yeah.
But, and everyone's just hanging on for that last scene where they're somehow in the internet.
Yeah, they're in the internet. the solution, spoilers for the Digimon movie, came out in 2000.
If you're hanging on, just mute it for a little bit.
Skip forward maybe 2
but
minutes.
But I don't think many people are worried if they're going to miss
the bad Digimon has been infected by a computer virus, OBS. It gets into the Pentagon and launches nuclear missiles at Earth, obviously.
Yeah.
You know, at Tokyo and at Washington.
Yep.
And then they go, the humans go into the internet where the Digimon are. Ogamon,
into the internet.
Ogamon and Greymon fucking fuse or some shit. No, that's the same Digimon.
No, they come together. Oh no, they go like metal versions.
Yeah, and then they fuse into one like dude, but he's still too slow, Sam.
I know, but then they're dying and then the kids go through the screen and yeah. They're like comforting them.
But do you remember how they solved, because the fused Digimon is still too slow to catch the like virus Digimon.
Yeah,
the they Bluetooth. Send him, they forward him all the emails and the emails catching up to him slows him down enough that they kill him.
How good is technology?
The power of email, Sam.
The power of Gmail.
But these are some of the... We've done.
This is.
We've done 6 minutes already on the Digimon movie.
This is by far the best start we have ever had to a podcast.
These are highlights of the Digimon movie soundtrack, music for the motion picture. Starts out with a cover of Kids in America by the band Len, otherwise only famous for Steal My Sunshine.
Yeah. But such a good cover.
So good.
Because I remember, this is even further niche for the Australian audience. I think it was, is it Angela Anaconda?
Yes, yes.
There was an intro in the movie and it was like a little scene where she's in a movie theater with like Johnny
and
the other ones.
Ninny?
Ninny Poo, yeah.
And yep, continue.
So they're in the movie theater and then they all of a sudden cut. Kids in America comes on, Digimon movie.
Well, Angela Anaconda and co. are going to the Digimon movie. That's the scene.
It's so good.
It's so good. So you've got...
I was 10.
Oh.
Not even that. Probably when I was like 6.
You would have been 3 when this movie came out. Not 6. To dox you.
No, that's okay.
So you've got Kids in America, covered by Len. You got All-Star Smash Mouth.
Yeah. Before Shrek even did
Before Shrek. The Rockefeller Skank by Fatboy Slim.
Yeah.
Huge.
1 week, Bare Naked Ladies.
Which is such a belter, hey.
It is. It's underrated.
It's the pinnacle of white man rap.
It is.
Eminem, sit down. The impression that I get by the Mighty Mighty Boss tones.
Yeah, look, I haven't really heard that since the movie.
Holds up, though.
Yeah, there's a few others in there that I don't... Digi Rap.
Yeah, but...
I want to know what that is.
All My Best Friends Are Metalheads by Less Than Jake.
Yeah.
Fucking awesome.
It's a star-studded playlist.
Oh.
Or soundtrack.
Sorry. It's enough to just get you, like... It's enough to make you warp Digivolve, Sam.
Digivolve 2!
Metal Garuruma.
Between that and talking about Dragon Force last week, we're off to a very nerdy start.
I think we're pivoting our podcast. People might have accidentally thought that we were cool at some point, but...
I swear we haven't lost our virginity. And you know what? I reckon our guests this week fuck with that soundtrack so hard.
I reckon you might be right.
So stay tuned. We've got the Pop-Punk boys Between You and Me on. Off the back of... their brand new EP, Shit Yeah.
Yep.
And fucking tell you what.
He's got a bit of slap to it, doesn't
it? Well, I was joined by Jake, who was in the toilet. Oh, so well. Stay tuned for that.
Forward sell,
but
Sam.
But Jake, if you're listening, all the Between You and Me boys, shout out. And let us know if you listen to the Digimon soundtrack.
Give us a, out of 10, give us a Digimon sound, Digimon the movie soundtrack review.
Oh, you wait. I'm going to find it on vinyl. I'm going to press my own vinyl. Anyway.
We've opened strong, Sam.
We've opened strong, and now we're on to something new.
Well, we've got something old, something new, Sam. I've been listening to an album that I know that you're going to be obsessed with to review this week.
You've been listening to a lot of the Wombats, have you?
Well, similar vibe. Vampire Weekend, Sam. They released a new album, Only God Was Above Us. And I knew you'd love that album. I don't hate it. It's pretty good.
I'm done.
For anyone who doesn't know Sam or has never listened to us before, Sam...
I fucking hate the Vampire Weekend.
Irrationally hates Vampire Weekend. And
why
I don't
do they
know
play
why.
Play their guitars up under their chins?
It was the time. Was it?
Me and your cousins and you and your cousins.
Yeah. That's. I mean, to be fair, that's how I describe both of our friend groups.
I'm not... Well... I think there's some... Anyway.
The
let's get through Vampire Weekend.
So like only God Was Above Us. Compared to a lot of their older albums.
Bit arrogant of it. Very arrogant. Title, isn't it?
Very arrogant from Ezra.
Very Vampire Weekend.
Very.
Isn't it?
There's no... I wouldn't say there's like... I've listened to it a couple times. I wouldn't say there's like a standout track yet. Like,
because there's none of them.
But all... all throughout... I'm going to make you listen to it one time. All throughout the record... I enjoyed listening. There was no point when I was like, I don't want to listen to this, which is, I'm sure you do the same. And but there just wasn't a time when I was like, this is the track.
That's
so
nice.
I'm going to give it a 3.5 stars.
Out of 15. Which is what it deserves. Well, that's good.
What's new with you, Sam?
Thank you for ruining the podcast. I've been listening to a bit of everything.
Oh, yeah.
Left, right, and placenta.
Yeah. Everything, or just everything?
No, just a little bit of everything.
Yeah, nice.
I discovered I'm a bit late to the party, but The Beaches.
Oh, yep. Blame Brett.
Blame Brett. That's such a sick song.
Banger.
banger.
Yeah.
I discovered it popped up on my Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
And the very beginning, that hook,
yeah,
is so cool.
It is. It is what you want from like indie punk.
Oh, it's everything I want indie music to be.
Yeah.
That it's not. Like, this is what the scene should be. And the scene's, anyway. Fucking Vampire Weekend. Oh, no. Well, I've pulled out something.
He's had a mare there. Are you still? No, you're still recording.
I'm still good. Lot in the Heavy World dropped. Alpha Wolf dropped a new album. Era dropped a new album. Knocked Loose dropped a new single.
Right.
Alpha Wolf's new album's hefty.
Yep.
Would highly recommend.
Thick.
Tick. Knocked Loose is new stuff. It's just Knocked Loose. It's,
yep.
It's like a dog yelling at you.
Mm.
So it's good at a, you know. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's that?
Friends of the show.
Friends of the show. Well, one of them. And then Lissy McAlpine.
Oh, yeah.
Dropped a new album.
Heavy. Heavy stuff. It's
so heavy.
Yeah.
Wanted to Love It.
Mm, oh. Trouble in Paradise, Sam.
Trouble in Paradise. I do love Lizzy. Wanted to Love It.
Yeah. Hasn't grabbed you.
So far. It hasn't grabbed me.
All right. Is it an album that you want to give a couple of goes to before
I'll have to give it a couple of goes. Okay. You know, I think when you're a long time listener.
Yeah. Long time, first time.
Long time listener, first time caller.
Yeah.
You just got to give it a couple of listens.
Yep.
So I've given it two, and I'm going to give it one more before I make my final decision. Right. But we're fucking thin ice.
Elizabeth.
Liz, if you're listening.
Is that it for you?
Thank you.
Yeah. Welcome to the show.
Welcome.
Do you like Digimon too?
I heard you're just coming to Australia. We'd love to have a chat.
Elizabeth Catherine McAlpine.
Well, I've been pronouncing her name wrong for the last 2 years.
What are you saying? McAlpine.
McAlpine.
I don't, you could be right. I don't know.
Whoa.
Well. You sound like Wario then.
Fucking Vampire Weekend. And we got recommended a song on our TikTok, a band called Lamphead.
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 Yeah. Not like, lamp feed.
No, lamp as in a light.
Yeah.
And then you put it on your head.
Yeah, but like Lamphead.
Yeah, Lamphead.
Could be a lamp feed, yeah.
Yeah, it could be.
But
well, it's EAD.
Right.
Yeah, not heed. Anyway, I have been loving their song Send Help UFO.
Oh, yeah.
It's very environmentally strong.
Vibe?
It's like indie rock.
Okay.
Like Aussie indie rock.
Okay, nice.
It's good.
All right. Well, shout out to Lamphead or Lamphead.
Lamphead. Lamphead.
You tell us.
But, yeah, very, very strong on the climate, I get the vibe.
Great.
No worries.
Speaking of Digimon, Sam.
Yes.
Going back.
Digivolve 2!
I can't take it seriously now. Because you could do... you could if you were at a costume party, you could do like a tie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With the spiky hair
and
the glasses.
Or a mat. Like I could see you in like the green like vest with like the gloves. Yeah. Yeah. I could do a Mimi.
Oh, yeah. She had the boxing one. The boxing cactus, didn't she?
Yeah.
That's how I know them all, based on like...
On the Digimon.
The Digimon.
Yeah. What was the coolest Digimon out of that group?
Well, I think it was Matt.
Matt.
He had the wolfy one.
Yeah, he did have the wolf one. Mm. I thought the guy, you know, the one that was like the, it was like a seal or like a walrus and it had like the big hammer? That thing fucking was sick.
And one of them was an insect and then turned into like a giant cockroach.
Yeah, that thing was also pretty dope.
That was cool.
Yeah.
See, Digimon fucking slaps.
Digimon really does fucking slap.
If anyone's listening, just get me anything Digimon related and I'll frame it. You reckon my girlfriend will like a framed Digimon print on the wall?
I think she may listen to this podcast and go, what have I gotten myself into?
You're making the assumption she listens to the podcast.
That's a good point, actually. You're safe.
Neither both of us are safe. We could be, this could be like Breaking Bad. We could be selling drugs.
Absolutely.
On our podcast and neither of our girlfriends would know.
We could be just slagging them off and we'd just be safe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This could be a dating.
Yeah, this podcast. Yeah, we're both here to
and
say,
no one would know.
Or, like in the '80s, how they did like auditions on like VHS tapes, and they'd be like, "Hey, my name's Max, and I like long walks on the beach, and I don't smoke." We should just do one of those and see all our girlfriends are like, "Have you guys been auditioning for other girlfriends?"
I'm gonna cue the music here. Hey, my name's Sam. I have social awkwardness, and I really enjoy Digimon. Looking forward to meeting you. You can call me anytime.
That was beautiful.
Thanks.
I think that can go well with my ad for the Red Cross I did last week. Are you in practice?
I couldn't find it. I looked so hard. To be fair, I was like,
John, I'll cut it for you.
You cut it for me. Yep. You just tell me the time codes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I was just skimming. And I was like, I could probably watch the whole podcast, but I won't. And I just skimmed.
Yeah. I'll find it for you. I'll send it over.
Blood.
Shout out the Bloods.
Evolutions, Sam.
Evolutions. So,
this is an idea, I think, I don't know, I might have stolen off TikTok, I don't know, but here we are. I would never do that, but here we are, Sam. I was thinking, so an artist or an album or something, a song, if you will, that's like quite accessible that a lot of people know, if you would like follow that to the next step of like going in a direction towards something less accessible, you know, what does that look like? What is? How do you go to something that's like the most refined form of whatever that is? So if you know, you start with, say, you start with like Frank Sinatra, how do you go to like the most jazz? You know what I mean? Something like that.
Probably buy
that was a bad example.
Probably buy a saxophone.
That's true.
See, I've taken it from my own experience.
Yeah.
So I've brought a little bit of a different angle to the table, which is,
please,
you know, it shows we don't do our show notes.
Yeah.
So I've taken the music I listen to now and then backtracked it to where it started.
Oh, yeah. That's a good idea.
So I have a theory that your music taste, whether you think so or not, is heavily, heavily influenced by the music your parents listened to when you were growing up.
Yep, yep.
So with that, I've got two.
Barbara Streisand.
My mum loves Barbara.
Who doesn't?
Me.
Well, you've never listened to Yentl.
Yentl. That's the joke we always make in the house.
Oh, bro, sorry.
Mum? Mum?
If you could edit that in, that'd be great.
So I've got two. I've got my dad's side and my mum's side.
Yeah.
So my dad started off when he was my age, big Crosby, Stills, and Nash. Crosby, Stills, and Nash fan.
Not Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young?
Well, I'm going to start that again because I fucked it up and it's going to ruin the social.
Okay.
So.
Your dad.
So I start with my dad.
Yeah.
Big Crosby, Stills, and Nash fan and obviously Neil Young.
Yeah.
And then that also became Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young.
Yeah.
So sort of like guitar-driven rock. Early 2000s, I'm around.
Yeah.
You know, still in nappies.
Watching Digimon the movie.
Watching Digimon. Linkin Park. He was a big fan of Numb by Linkin Park.
Oh, sick.
Great song.
Yeah.
So growing up, always had Linkin Park around.
Mm-hmm.
As I got a little bit older, got into the heavier side of Linkin Park. That then goes into Amity Affliction because you like the heaviness with the cleans.
Yep, yep, yep.
From there, you find bands like Northlane, who at the time didn't have cleans.
Yeah, it was just heavy.
It's just heft, but you like the guitars.
Yep.
And then that shifts. Mm. So from there, you get like Alpha Wolf, who was super heavy.
Yep.
Or Throne, who were crazy out of Sweden.
Yep.
And then if that doesn't do it for you, you can go even heavier.
Yeah.
That's where you go into like Die Hard is Murder, Justice for the Damned, Virtues, Meshuggah. So I didn't come from like, I listen to heavy music, but I didn't come from a Metallica, Iron Maiden background, which is where most people start. I started in like the Linkin Park, Lenny Kravitz actually.
Ooh, I do love a bit of Lenny.
Yeah.
But Lenny,
my first CD was Greatest Hits by Lenny Kravitz.
I feel like Lenny, like he's founded in rock.
Mm.
But Lenny wrote a lot of like real like pop stuff.
Yeah. Like, his big songs were rock, but his deep cuts are all sort of like.
But also like stuff that he wrote for other people. I'm gonna let you continue, but I remember there's a maybe Madonna song or something like that that's really like a. He wrote for someone else. It's probably not Madonna now that I say it, but that was very poppy.
Well, there you go. But that sums up the rock side of my. The rock and heavy side of my taste and where it's come from a. I guess a rock background, because Nickelback were big in that early 2000s. People give them shit now, but at the time, they slapped. I was going to swear again.
They flapped.
They flapped.
I feel that.
They flopped.
With a quick view, I can't find
the
song I was looking for, but I do remember that he was in Austin Powers' Spy Who Shagged Me.
Yeah, and he was in The Hunger Games.
Yeah, he was, wasn't he? Was he? He'd formerly been in there, or was he?
The fashion style.
That's what he was. Yeah, he's also in Zoolander. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah,
yeah.
He's got a big dong.
Yeah, he does actually. Explosively big dong. That thing erupts out.
Well, it certainly breaks the thread.
Speaking of broken threads, Sam, let's pick up the one that we had before. I think
pleased with that one, were you?
Yeah, thank you. Everyone loves Blink 182, right?
I knew you were going to go down a pop-punk element.
Yeah, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to go artists that are still within the Blink-182 expanded universe.
Yep.
You know, the Blink-180 MCU, the Blink... Here we go. Blink-180
CU.
Well,
yeah. 1-8...
CU.
1-CU?
The 1-8-U.
The 1-8-U. 1-CU.
Well, yeah, either of those works.
Well, it'll be 1-MU, musical universe.
Yeah, Blink-1-MU.
Fuck, this is a nerdy episode.
Fucking know if it is. This is pretty bad in front.
I don't think I've watched a Marvel movie since like...
The last one that came out.
The Avengers one. Where they're all in it or something.
I love how you're pretending not to know. You know, the Avengers and they're all in it. It's Iron Man and it's Captain America. The Hulk. I love it when he's the Green Hulk. Anyway.
That green what's his name? The Green Fella.
You know, he's quite hulking.
Yeah, he's a hulking man. They should call him. Cranky.
But okay, so other bands in the Blink CU, if you will, Blink 1 CU.
Yeah.
I think the first and most obvious way to go if you love Blink and you want to take the next step, Angels and Airwaves.
Well, naturally.
It's everything that Blink is now, you know, you get a little taste of that in especially I Empire by Angels and Airwaves, one of the all time great albums. So good.
Yep.
You know, you've got Secret Crowds, Call to Arms, all those kind of bangers that just smash. Great stuff.
Bend You Over and Smash.
Exactly. And then if you want to go another step and still down the Tom DeLonge line, say.
I thought you were going to say plus 44.
Well, no, I'm not calling England, Sam. I'm going for a Boxcar Racer.
Oh, yep.
Which was Travis and Tom. Yeah. And the one that everyone knows, well, not everyone, but one that a lot of people know from Boxcar Racer is There Is. Mm. But that album actually is pretty solid all round, to be honest.
There you go.
It's certainly not going to be what you expect from Blink-182. But it's
in the CU, the MU.
It's in the Blink-18 CU.
Would you throw in, say, a Sum 41? Are they a little bit heavier?
Well, I'd say they're not in the Blink CU because we're not sharing members, you know.
Oh, true.
But, similar vibe. Very
are you
much
put
so.
Plus 44 in there?
I mean, plus 44. The one that Mark Hoppus is in with Alex Gaskar, Simple Pleasures, Simple Creatures.
We've interviewed them, haven't we?
Nah, we interviewed Alex Gaskarth.
Simple Creatures, maybe. Simple Creatures, maybe.
But that was actually pretty good. So there's a few in the expanded Blink CU. Amy Shark technically is in the expanded Blink CU because I think she's got a song with Mark Hoppus.
Yeah.
So.
You know who's in the Linkin Park CU?
Who's that?
Between You and Me.
Yeah, right.
I think.
Was Chester also in Between You and Me?
No.
Not for long.
I went to look up Mike Shinoda, and because I was thinking Blink, I was looking up a bloke called Mark Shinoda. Far out. Already Over? A bunch of people performed on Already Over.
Yeah, right.
I think. Yeah, Between You and Me.
There you go.
Stan Atlantic, Between You and Me, and Polaris.
We could be drawing up a little mind map here.
It's like the Charlie Day. Like.
Yeah. We are as crazy. So yeah, if you want to explore the Blink-182 and the Blink-18 CU...
Angels and Airwaves.
Angels and Airwaves, Boxcar Racer. And we'll throw in plus 44 for some gigs.
When Your Heart Stops Beating.
Oh, banger.
It's a great song.
Yeah.
You know how confused I was?
Yeah.
When I saw plus 44's music video for that. And I was like...
Where's Thomas?
I was like, I don't think this is plus 44. I think this is Blink-182.
Who's the other person in plus 44 that's not Mark? Oh, that's actually...
Travis.
Yes. Yep. Mm-hmm. And?
Machine Gun Kelly.
Shane Gallagher of The Nervous Return. And Craig Faribault of Mercy Killers.
Didn't they do well?
Took off, Sam. Took off. In the sense of ran away.
Yeah.
But anyway, Sam, have you got another...
Yes, I do.
Music evolution.
So in the same vein.
Yeah.
I'm a bit of a sad boy. I really like sad music.
No, never.
No, it's different, isn't it?
Yeah.
But I traced back my ancestry, ancestry.com.
Yeah.
And I went back and realised that my mum is very into, as we said before, Barbara Streisand, Tracy Chapman...
Papa, the one can that... you hear me? Sorry.
Anyway, I don't know the rest of the words. We just say Yentl every time. Yentl. But Joni Mitchell was a big one for my mother.
Yep, yep.
River.
Oh.
One of the saddest songs of all time.
Mm.
But geez.
But it's a deeper cut than like you say your Big Yellow Taxi.
Yeah, I didn't actually... I liked the Counting Crows version.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm a Gen whatever. But River...
Yeah.
I think everyone in the world, most people in existence know River, certainly have heard it. Some people think it's too sad. Some people really like it. You think it's too sad.
Mm-hmm.
You said in Love Actually, you're going to bawl your bloody eyes out.
Yeah, that's the movie, though, not the song.
Yeah, well, it's still the song. It's got some deep cuts. But anyway, so I started Joni Mitchell. I was like, okay, River.
Yeah.
From there, my mum and dad also like Sarah McLachlan.
Oh, yeah.
Same vein.
So, yeah, similar.
From there, you go, okay, take it to the modern day.
Mm-hmm.
Lizzie McAlpine. McAlpine. So you've got Joni Mitchell, you go down to Sarah McLachlan, you go to Lizzie McAlpine,
mm-hmm.
and then from Lizzie McAlpine,
mm-hmm.
it's like a big tree. It just branches. It just branches. So Sarah's is one that I'm loving at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Really great.
As in C-E-R-E-S?
C-E-A-R, like arrows, but with an S-E at the front. C-Rose, Sarah.
Oh, like C-Arrows. Like
C-Arrows.
Okay, like, but, okay, yep. That's actually a really hard name to pronounce.
I don't know how to pronounce it.
Yeah.
It's like Sarah's, Sarrows. I don't know how to pronounce it. S-E-A, it's like pear with an S and then rose at the end. But pear, it's only one R. I'll show you.
Oh, yeah.
Sarrows, I'll just call it.
Pear with an S was probably the worst way you could describe that because pear you can spell P-A-I-R.
P-A-I-R.
Yeah, like a pair of shoes.
Like two.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, nice.
Yep.
But from there you go like Sarrows, Delaney Bailey. There's a lot. Charlie Adams. There's a lot that you can go down in that avenue that's a bit niche.
Yep.
But if you start from like a Joni Mitchell or your mum and dad listen to Joni Mitchell, the world's your oyster.
You're in.
So if I was to backtrack.
Yeah.
So I've gone backtrack instead of going the deep cuts.
Yep. I like that. I like that.
I never do anything properly. I don't read instructions.
That's fine. It still works. I think I've got one that's probably the exact opposite to sad boy vibes.
Who knew?
Classic me.
Talk and cheese.
If you like a flight facility, Sam, you like a flight facility?
I like their Claire de Lune.
Who doesn't?
I mean,
all time great hits.
Telstra had to fucking come in and shout out our sponsors, Telstra.
But flight facilities, you know, make good, solid, what we would call balcony dance music. Oh, sorry, not balcony dance music. What have we called that before? Deck music? We've had a name for it. Music that you listen to in the afternoon.
Yeah, it's like sunset. Sunset bush doofs.
Yeah, you've had maybe a few vodka lime and sodas at the Fox Hotel,
you're wearing your best button up t-shirt.
Oh,
and your top knot's hanging loose.
Yeah, the RMs have got a bit of spilt liquid on them.
Your dad's RMs.
Dad's RMs. Yeah. Obviously, yeah.
I should also preface that Telstra does not sponsor this show.
No, they don't. But flight facilities, you know, they started around the 2010, 2011 mark. I want to go backwards from there. They sort of took over in my mind from a band called Miami Horror, who a lot of listeners will probably know of. Songs like Sometimes, Holiday, All There Ever Was, Bangers. But
is that actually their song?
Not that one. That's Madonna.
Yeah, I think
so. But
just testing you.
Yeah.
Talk and cheese, like I said.
So Miami Horror, another great Australian sort of... I'd put them in a similar vein of that like late afternoon vibe, but... a bit more dancey than flight facilities, I'd say.
Yep.
So like later in the evening, perhaps.
Probably like a 6 or 7.
Sun's just dipped.
Like, it's just dipped.
Yeah. Like there's still probably a little bit of like lingering light in the sky, but the sun itself is over the horizon.
I'd even push it back. 6:30 till 8.
Yeah.
Whereas flight facilities are very much 4:30 till 6.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And then if we're going to go one step further, we're taking it, the sun is right down now.
Yep.
Maybe there's some light neon light getting around, you know, some fairy lights have come in, something like that. Muscles, another Australian act, most famous for Ice Cream, which was the song, but Guns Babes Lemonade was that album, and full of just absolute dance floor classics.
And they were before,
and they were around, I'd say Ice Cream by Muscles was around 2007.
So over the years we've pulled back.
Yeah, we've gone back in time, but
we've
gone back in years, Sam, but forward in the afternoon. See what we've done there?
Back in time, but back in the afternoon.
Yeah, exactly. Well, yeah, that's true.
So night is actually after afternoon.
Day becomes night, Sam.
Yeah.
And 2012 becomes 2007. If you're in that same mood, you could also explore like a Panal, a Presets, a whole heap of other bands.
LDRU.
Lots of other Australian, that sort of Australian dance music ADM vibe that was kind of big at the time.
And then if you want to go like... midnight to 1 a.m.
Yep.
That's where you get like your shock ones.
Oh, a pendulum.
Your pendulums. Mm. That's when you're chewing your lips to high heaven.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Maybe even some... I'd say the connecting tissue between those two things, maybe a Peking duck.
Mm, they're like they could probably do the 9 till 11:30 yeah. set, and then you give it half an hour.
Yeah.
Just to let the DJ swap.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we've planned your night. If you're not Australian and you don't know any of those bands,
well, that's 100%
you should check that out.
Well, that's why we say this is a music discovery podcast.
We have said that.
No, we haven't. It's just a hashtag we use on our socials, which you should follow, by the way.
I wanted to throw a challenge at you, though, Sam.
No worries. Just interrupt my plug.
I know. I wanted to throw a challenge at you before the plug.
No worries.
Because I thought you were moving through the plug.
No, that's I wasn't. I was just being impromptu, plugging it subtly, and now it's really awkward.
Plug me up, Sam.
I don't feel safe in this podcast anymore.
If I started with Violent Soho, Sam.
Yes.
Where would you go from there? Free range. However you want to do it.
Bands that can't sing.
Yep.
Idols.
Idols. Okay. Mm. All right. Idols. Fontaine's DC, perhaps?
Oh, I think they can sing.
Really?
No, I haven't really listened to them.
I mean...
I was just backing them up.
They obviously have a lot of fans. Not for me.
I did listen to... They're very Irish.
Very. But in that... Like...
Top of the morning to you.
Joy Division, if somehow they were more depressing.
Mm. Yeah, then... I saw them... Really high on the Splendor lineup. I was like, that's a way to kill an afternoon.
That's not flight facilities in the on the Sunset slot.
Well, no one's playing Splendor this year, so.
R.I.P.
Ave Maria. Anyway, Violent Soho, what would I say? Brisbane bands, probably.
Oh, okay, Brizzy. Yeah,
4122 crew.
Yep, yeah, yep.
Why do you ask?
Well, I want to throw an evolution chain at you. I want to see how you go with that.
Oh, starting this is the evolution chain.
Starting with
you said you had a game for me.
That was the challenge. That is a challenge. Create like a little.
Sorry, because we talked off air that you also had a game. So.
Oh, I mean, I can still do that too, but
no, that's okay.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's fine. Yeah.
You know, sorry for being confused. Okay, so Violent Soho, are we going forward or backwards?
Mate, you tell me.
I think we should go forward.
Sure.
Because I can't go much further back.
Sure.
Violent Soho.
But it doesn't have. It can be lateral.
Well, I think if you go lateral from Violent Soho, you'd go June Rats.
Yep.
You'd go DZ Death Rays.
Mm-hmm.
If you went forwards, you'd go... Depends how forward you want to go. You'd throw in maybe... Oh, I'd put Skeggs in that realm.
Yep.
Who would you put in?
Mm.
Most of the Splendor lineups of the last 5 years, probably.
I feel like...
Hockey Dad.
Like a Silver Sun pickups.
Oh, yeah.
Not Australian.
No.
But
there is some crossover there.
Yeah, I'd say a similar vibe. I'd go so far as to put, and this might be working back, we might be doing this the opposite way around. I feel like if you're starting in a Nirvana, you could pretty easily get to a Violent Soho.
I think you could.
Maybe through a Silver Sun pickups.
And a Silver Chair, probably.
Yeah, probably through a Silver Chair. Yeah, yeah.
I'd probably
early say. Silver Chair.
Early Silver Chair. You go from lines. A Nirvana to an early Silver Chair.
Yeah.
Maybe into a Silver Sun pickups.
Yeah. Maybe to an early Regurgitator or something like that.
Yeah, the Gurge.
The Gurge.
Into a Violent Soho.
Yeah.
Into a DZ.
Yep.
Probably into a Hockey Dad.
Well, yeah, from a DZ, it starts to get poppy again from there.
Yeah, you go like a Hockey DZ into Hockey Dad into Skeggs probably.
Yeah.
And then from Skeggs you go as far.
Yeah. The scene, basically what we're saying is the scene blowing up in Brisbane between like 2009 and 2015.
It's all the same.
Fucking Mint Bickies.
Mid Bickies, but every band sounded the same.
Voho, Death Rays, Junies, Ballpark,
yep.
Jungle Giants.
Yep.
Yeah. There's some good ones we left off the list, but yeah.
Yeah.
Velociraptor.
Velociraptor. Dinosaur. No, that's Last Dinosaurs?
Yeah. Last Dinos, yeah. They're in that gang.
Never saw them.
I saw them at a Big Sound, maybe?
Amity Affliction.
Amity Affliction. Sam, so that social plug you were talking about.
Drowning in the Undertow. I'm so fucked up drowning in the Undertow.
I always liked the crossover Illy.
Oh, Youngblood.
Youngblood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's when you knew.
Because remember how, like, this is a real relic of the time, when the white Australian rap kids and the white Australian metal kids had the same, like, sweepy-doo?
Yeah.
And, like, they'd always wear, the same baseball cap. So you'd be like, are you going to rob me for my... like Nikes on the train because you're a Australian rap fan, or are you going to try and stab me with like a syringe of your own blood because you're an Australian metal fan?
It was a strange time, wasn't it?
Yeah, there's a real crossover there.
It was. It was all just... Well, because at the same time, Justin Bieber was blowing up, so...
Yeah.
Everyone across the board had sweeping comb-overs.
Well, as they used to say, when you saw a sweep your fringe, if you see a hat, there's illy in that, If you see a singlet, Amity is... Fuck, I'm really struggling with this one.
Well, it depends on the, depending on the color of the singlet. If it was a black singlet,
that's true.
They're into metal.
Yeah.
If they were of a color.
Yeah. If the singlet is black, Amity at the back of the shirt. If the singlet is string, it's an illy thing.
Yeah.
As we used to say, that's an easy one to remember. That's a quick mnemonic for you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just even go as far to say, if it's a singlet that's not Hurley,
yeah,
for it is illy, Shirley.
Those straws were being really clutched out there.
In terms of creativity, I think I won that one.
Yeah, I think so.
Anyway,
before we throw to our interview with, we're going to say Bring Me the Horizon, Between You and Me.
I don't really know. I wouldn't wish that because I do like Between You and Me. You want me to plug the socials now?
Yeah,
I'd
love a plug.
I was trying to plug them before.
Yeah.
Well, if you like this or... this sounds weird. But basically, if you find this at all interesting, just follow it on Spotify if you like it. And if you want to see us more on socials or if you don't listen to it on YouTube, that doesn't make sense. We're really bad at promoting ourselves, aren't
we? Yeah, we're not good at this.
We're not...
just
we're so humble. Just I was pointing my...
Senpai, look at me. just follow
at 7 a.m. everywhere if you are interested.
Yeah.
TikTok's the place to be at the moment. We've got a nice little community there.
Yep, we do.
And look, the numbers on the podcast are...
Growing. Stick around here as well after the interview for a bit of Vinyl Club.
It's where we put on our nicest velvet coats, take off our sneakers and really get to know each other and... more importantly, you and our music. But for now, let's go to Between You and Me because we're with Jakey Boy, the lead singer. They've just dropped a brand new EP called Shit Yeah. It's like nostalgic pop punk.
Mm.
It's like that feel good. It's not the I hate my town, I hate growing up, my parents don't understand me.
Yep.
It's that like
it's not modern baseball.
No. Not neck deep either.
Yeah.
But it's that time just before it. Like Blink 182, Less Than Jake, Bowling for Soup era, where...
Could it fit on the Digimon movie?
Yeah, you could.
Yeah.
It was probably a little bit more upbeat than the Digimon movie was. Maybe in the early parts. Maybe part one or two of the movie.
Yeah, before the existential crisis of the rabbit with machine gun arms.
Yeah. Yeah. But no, it's a really fun EP. Jakey Boy joins us all the way from America in the bog.
Wow.
And there are a few technical difficulties that comes with the territory being on the other side of the world.
In the shitter.
But stick with it, in the shitter, Between You and Me. Throw over to me.
Rightio, joining us all the way from a Newark bathroom is the Aussie pop
proof in the pudding.
It's taken a little bit of...
for all you guys know.
Yeah, I mean, it is just shoulder up, so we'll leave the rest of the imagination, but...
This is so bootleg.
It is, but that's okay. It's about being adaptive and being able to be versatile and think on your feet. So with that, we are joined by JT from Between You and Me. Mate, how's it going?
What's going on, mate? Thanks for having me. I'm just currently enjoying my well-needed off day after six in a row. So I'm just chilling today. Probably going to use up the rest of this.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you on, man. Like I said on the top, I mean, thanks, you're man. Joining us from Newark in the States. You're playing a huge run of shows at the moment. I mean, talk to me about that because it's looked absolutely mental so far.
It is very mental, you know, like especially because I've never done a long amount of like headline shows where we sing for like an hour, you know. So that's just been like a challenge in itself. And then, you know, just the whole process that goes into, you know, setting up the show, packing down the show.
But I wanted to ask you about that because you're playing pretty much a whole month's worth of shows with almost a show every single night. So How, I mean, I've never been in a touring band. The logistical part of it, I've got no idea. But to me, it sounds like a nightmare at times. So how do you guys go about finding moments to enjoy it while getting lost in the, without getting lost in the franticness?
It's, that's a good question. Because it is hard when it's like a moving circus, you know. You get in early, you set up, play, maybe grab a bite to eat, maybe pack down, and then you do the whole same thing the next day. Like, because we don't really have, you know, there's bands that have like crew to like set up stuff and whatever, but we're very hands-on. So like that, us like take saving money and packing down the set means like 3 a.m. bed calls for us every day. So it's like, it's definitely like the schedule's interesting, can be grueling, but I don't know. I love it. I love the day to day. I love the, what might seem boring is like kind of fun to me. So,
yeah. Wow. 3 a.m. That's rough. Are you getting any sleep?
No, and that's the one thing I need as a singer is sleep, and I'm not getting Today I should just be like...
You should be zonked today. Well, yeah, I mean, what time is it over there now? 5:30-ish?
Yeah, close to 5:30. Maybe I'll have some breakfast. Haven't eaten today yet. That's another thing that's weird on tour. Like, there's no sense of time. Like, I could have breakfast at 8 a.m. or I could have it at 4 p.m. or I might not even have it.
Yeah, wow. And it doesn't matter. It's just the ball just keeps rolling.
Keep going. Red Bulls, coffee.
Yeah, that's it. That's all you need. Well, we should talk new music because by the time this episode drops, Shit Yeah will be officially out. And if you're listening to this, go jump on it. It's a great EP. But, I mean, before we jump into that in itself, I want to talk new music for you. And so if you could go into your Spotify, your Apple Music, whatever you use to listen to music, what is currently spinning on your playlist, your tour playlist as of late?
All right. So we're touring with a band called Home Safe, who I've been listening to since before I was in our band. And I've just been like, I've got 5 songs on repeat from them. But I made a little playlist. The song that I've got on repeat is Hold On by Home Safe. So if you're listening, chuck it on. Chuck it on repeat. Bump the boys.
Love it. And, I mean, for those who have no idea who Home Safe are, if you know Knuckle Puck, you'll certainly like Home Safe. It's Ryan, from the bassist from Knuckle Puck.
3-piece rock and roll band. Yeah.
That's it. Love it. Well,
the only band that uses amps.
You guys all running plugins, are you? I don't want to expose you guys.
We all run Kempers and...
Kempers, yeah.
And all that stuff. Oh, it's all that new age shit.
That's all right. You just make sure your mic's plugged in and let the boys worry about that, wouldn't you?
Exactly. That's it, mate.
Well, let's talk Shit Yeah then, because it's a brand new EP. It's a really fun sound. It's quite nostalgic in the way it sort of presents itself. It makes me think of like the good old feel good 2000s, early 2000s pop punk. I mean, what was the approach to this one? It just sounds like you had heaps of fun with
honestly,
it.
Honestly, zero approach, if I'm going to be real with you. We're kind of just like, we've been pretty busy and we're like, we should put out some music. So we kind of like got a house together like near the beach and just jammed some ideas. We had like so many musical ideas, but I think we kind of just picked a few. We're like, these sound good, and we're just like kind of experimenting. We'd never really done. We're pretty unprepared. Well, I was pretty unprepared going into this. So like, we kind of just like looking through the songs and going, oh, this sounds cool. This sounds cool. Let's do this. This sounds cool. You know. So. Yeah. And I think, and for me, like, not all, as our first independent release, I guess, since prior to signing with our old label. So, I know we didn't want to do a full record, but like, let's just put out an EP, just put out some music, and then we'll continue writing music down the track. It's a good collection of songs. It's interesting, like, it goes from one side to the other. There's, like, the one called Sad Songs is, like, I don't know, really strange for us, but I kind of like it. And then you got like, you know, other songs that kind of throw back to our old sound. So I think there's a good mix in there for old and new listeners, you know.
Mm. And from a, I mean, I guess from a songwriter perspective, was it a nice change for you guys just to go, that sounds cool, let's put that in, rather than having the pressures of writing a full length in a studio and that sort of, you know, all the pressures to come with that?
Yeah, I still found pressure because sometimes you just go through a bit of a drought, and there's just like, there wasn't much of my own shit that I had going on to write about. So I had to kind of draw from other places, and that was definitely interesting for us. I didn't finish the vocals for like 8 months after we started it. We recorded it in like February or March, or we started the EP, and then I didn't finish vocals for all of them until like November.
Far out. Yeah, right.
Sometimes you just keep throwing stuff at a wall and nothing works.
I mean, how do you approach writer's block then? I mean, obviously that's a huge gap between sessions. What do you do to try and, you know, break that sort of...
It's hard. Like, because especially trying to top our second record, like you don't want to be, you know, you always want to be doing better and whatever. So I feel like that was a lot of pressure I was putting on myself. Whereas like there was no like external pressure. I was just in my head. I was like, damn, I should have came in more prepared, perhaps. But I think it's cool, like just the fact that we chose this group of songs at this point of time in our life, in our career or whatever. And, you know, it's good to look back on and go, that's what we were vibing in 2023, whatever it was. I think that's what it was.
Yeah.
You know, and like the next release could be completely different. I think that's the cool thing about writing songs, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, there is a cheeky crossover with Knuckle Puck in there as well. We're talking home safe, so it's only fitting that Knuckle Puck come up as well. But there's quite a blossoming bromance going on here, it seems. There's photos of you guys together everywhere. You've got home safe on tour. Is there something you guys aren't telling us?
No, I mean, like, you know, you get to meet a lot of bands, you know, touring and stuff. And we've looked up to Knuckle Puck for a long time. And I feel like from our perspective, I'm like, man, they've been doing this for years. Like they could very easily just be, you know, play the show, go to a hotel, not talk, you know, but we got along with them like instantly. When we started the tour with them in, fuck, I can't remember, it was like April or something last year. And we were just, you know, good friends from the get-go. So it's good to have a bit of crossover in music and on this tour as well.
And, I mean, going into the next month or so, you guys are coming back to home soil, which will be, I can imagine, a bit of sweet relief.
Yeah, I've been gone for a while. It'll be the longest, I think, we've ever been on tour in a row. It's like 2 months or something.
Yeah, wow.
Away from Australia, so it'd be nice to get home and just kind of get back into the swing of normal life, but also very quickly there is the Australian shows coming up, so not too much time to rest.
Yeah, not a heap, but that's okay. That's what you want. Packed schedule.
Yeah.
You're bringing the legends and very close friends of ours, Towns, on tour with you.
Yes.
Great. Have you seen them live?
I have. It's an exciting show, and I think we'll fit perfectly, you know.
Oh, it's gonna pop off, that's for sure. But it must be a relief for you to, I mean, especially days like today when you're stuck in Newark of all places, to think that in a month's time you'll be playing a home show and you'll be able to sleep in your own bed after the show. Like that must be
exactly. I know.
Unreal.
I know. It's too nice of a thought to think of right now. So I got to stay focused on the task at hand, and then I'll end up in my own bed soon enough. But, you know, I don't mind where I sleep as long as I get to do this fun job. You know, sleep on the floor. My back will be feeling it though.
Makes for a good story down the line. Maybe when you...
It does, it does.
You're in your lazy boy. I'm
getting surgery on my spine.
Yeah. But on a serious note, you guys are playing every major city, there's some really hefty size stages you're hitting as well. I think you guys said these are some of the stages you've grown up watching your favorite bands on. So, I mean, for you guys to be playing that, it must be, sort of surreal.
It is. It's scary. Like, I, as much as I love headlining and supporting, like, I feel like it's definitely less stressful when you're not headlining. There's a lot of stuff to worry about and kind of dwell on. But I don't know, like, I'm sure the shows are going to be insane. Every time we play home, you know, it's mental. So I think it's be great. Like, old songs, new songs, you know, big stages. And what do you want? Sleep. I mean, I want sleep.
I was going to say, sleep's probably the one thing you want. Yeah. But, you know, you're not going to be – you'll be at your own home. It's okay. You'll be fine.
I will.
Well, for everyone at home listening, Shit Yeah by Between You and Me is officially out everywhere today. So go stream the shit out of that one. And while you're at it, grab a ticket to their Australian headline tour in May, kicking off in Melbourne. JT, it's been a pleasure to have you on. We've had some tech issues. You're joining me from the bathroom, but either way, it's been great.
Thanks, mate. If you're listening, I'm showing the toilet right now. You're not missing out on much, eh? Thanks for having me on, though. Sorry about all the tech difficulties, everyone. Check out Shit Yeah. Hope y'all like it. Come see us at a show. We're heaps of fun, and we're really nice people. Why are you always trying to kill my vibe? You've been going all night. Now you say you gotta take some time. Well, that's just fine with me. You make it easier to hate your guts. I'm leaving you, because it's not so fun. You're out for blood. Why you always gotta kill my vibe?
You're not even recording.
Came in slightly early, but yeah.
Fuck. I'm just going to...
You grab that, yeah.
So for those in Vinyl Club, you should be aware that this is not videoed.
There's no video on this one.
We turn off the cameras and it's just you and me.
Amped after dark, if you will.
You fucked up my little punchline. There are no cameras here, everybody. It's just you and me. That's disgusting, Mac.
As they say, Sam... if you're recording in the shitter, the episode's a hitter. If you record in the studio, you want to record 2DO because the first one's going to suck.
I've got nothing for you there.
Yeah, I've got nothing for me either.
That was disgusting.
Well, welcome to Vinyl Club.
Welcome to Vinyl Club, everyone. Max and I have kicked off the shoes. As I said, we've got our velvet jackets on.
Yep. Sam took his pants off. I said, whoa, with the jocks off, we might just leave that there. Oh, excuse me. I'm just pulling up some TikToks for liner notes and forgot about the volume on there.
That's embarrassing, isn't it?
Oh, no, you got the big jobs.
What am I looking up? So, Max, we actually are on air. You shouldn't just scroll your phone willy-nilly and not engage with your co-host.
Do what I fucking want. It's my podcast. And yours. We share it. You can do what you want, too.
Well, clearly, I didn't wear underpants. Sorry, Mum.
I'm just pulling
Mum's
up.
Not listening either. What am I?
For people who are new to Vinyl Club, we do it a liner nights. We talk about some correspondence from the people. We talk
we
about
do.
The our people's opinions.
That we do.
Yeah.
So what are we? Whose opinions are we looking at today?
Well, one of the ones that you put out this week that I think got a bit of traction.
It's been a little bit halted. Our social media, because for you guys on the audio streams, I have had COVID.
Mm.
So I've been a little bit down and out. And then I spent an hour editing video only for Universal to block it. So
classic.
I was filthy.
You get that on Rivable. The larger
you do.
Work.
Livid, even.
But you asked the people, what are some good songs on shit albums? And we got some interesting responses there. First of all, James Rooker said horrid take on Slipknot. You suggested Slipknot
Duality.
Duality was a good song on a shit album. Sorry, James has said, how about you go fuck yourself?
Did he really?
No, he didn't say that. He said shit, that's a horrid take.
I think James should go fuck himself.
I suggested California by Blink on the album California. Sorry, Bored to Death on the album California. Yeah. Absolute belter.
You got two likes on that. Well done.
Thank you.
Yep. Stray Half from Green Day off North.
Yep.
Is that the one where they had three albums in?
Yeah.
That no one listened to?
Look, that was coming off the back of my Green Day fandom, and I listened to all of them. I would say across the three albums, there is one album's worth of good song.
Yep.
Yep.
So that's like 30 songs. So it's one in three.
They were a pretty thick album. I'm going to say there's almost 40 songs on that trio.
Oh, so it's one in four chance.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, you play the percentages there.
Yeah, yeah.
Teenage Dirtbag, Weedus.
True facts.
Name one other Weedus song.
Yeah, no, yeah.
Sorry. Someone said, dude, you live in Brisbane.
Yes.
No, I don't.
I live in... I wasn't just about to dox you then, but I won't say that.
No.
The other one...
People were really unhappy that I called Volume 3 a shit album.
Yeah, you were getting some heat.
But, you know, opinions are like assholes, and they didn't follow me, so fuck you.
Opinions like assholes, and Volume 3 came out of one. You also talked about, off the back of a conversation we had last week about Joe. That's getting cut. You talked about how, you shared a video of...
Dojo.
Dojo, their set being shit live.
Terrible.
Man, it was terrible, but people were not having a good time with that. People are like, no, please, you got to go listen to their other stuff.
Yeah, but that's because, see, this is the beauty of social media, Max. You come across like you're offended by it.
Yeah.
And you want people to support you.
That's true.
And they did.
Yeah. There's a lot of people defending Joe in that thing.
Music was never meant to be his... Oh, I've got COVID still. You finished.
Music was never meant to be... Sorry, that's really. I shouldn't be laughing. Music was never meant to be his main act. He does it as a hobby. He probably never thought his songs would blow up so soon, which means he's not had time to practice and perform the songs live.
Sorry, music was never meant to be his main act, but he acts it as a hobby. He probably never thought his songs would blow up so soon, which means he's not had time to practice and perform the songs live.
That's actually preform, actually.
That's actually perform Basameo, you flipping legend.
You put too much punctuation into the spoken version of that. There is no punctuation in that whatsoever.
Well, I certainly didn't put a full stop in it, did I?
No, you didn't. Sam, one of the other pieces of correspondence that we've started receiving.
Foreign correspondent Max Higgins on the job.
Foreign correspondent. Has been songs that bands have been sending us in the DMs.
Yes.
So I'm going to announce it here, only in Vinyl Club.
Yep.
That if you send us some songs and you tell us that you heard us say this in Vinyl Club.
Yep.
I will endeavor to listen to them. I'm not guaranteeing I'll listen to all of them, but I'll endeavor to listen to them and give you a little thought.
Well, on that note, you keep going because at the moment, I think I've got a pimple up my nose.
I was going to say, you got it there? You're really digging.
The first one I wanted to pull out of the list.
You're going to China with a spoon over here.
You're really going for it. Was by the band The Fortitudes, who I can only assume are from Brisbane. The song is When I'm With You.
Yep.
It's good. It's that indie punk kind of, you know, general vibe. Flashing back to the Brizzy. Really get in there, Sam. Really digging.
Got it.
Got him. Really getting back into that Brizzy 2010 scene. It's fun. It's light. I think, like, it to me, it feels really raw. I think if we got a bit more production behind it to really polish it up, it could really be something fantastic. But I think there's a lot of potential in it. So The Fortitudes, I don't know how long you've been playing, but...
shout out The Fortitudes.
Yeah, I think 40. there's definitely some potential in there. And When I'm With You, worth a listen. That's a thumbs up from me. That's an add to the playlist from me.
I like it. I actually received one privately as well.
Yeah.
That I'll bring to the table.
Oh, no, here we go.
No, I did, literally.
No, I'm sure you did, but that's what scares me.
No, it's from a Brisbane band. They're called Virtues. their new song, Grave Eater.
Yeah.
So they've written a whole spiel here. Their guitarist wrote us a whole short story.
Oh, what's Millsy been doing?
Well, I haven't read it. But, you know, it seems very Thy Art is
Murder over there, Sam.
I dropped my phone, sorry. It comes across very Thy Art is Murder.
Yep.
And if you're not into that, you probably won't be into this song.
Sure.
So on that note, shout out Virtues.
Okay.
And it says their guitarist...
That's just two blokes wanking.
Well, it says their guitarist is thinking about quitting the band to take up professional pickleball.
Oh. He wouldn't be very good at that.
He loves it.
He does.
That and hand tennis, apparently.
Oh. Like foursquare, like handball.
Well, I don't know.
I could see him being like, actually, that was doubles.
Well, deuce. I don't know where that came from. He wears a suit on stage, is what I've heard. Oof. So he must be a little bit of a wanker.
I also sent you some homework last week,
yes,
Sam.
You did.
What you were reviewing, I believe.
I was watching, or reviewing even, The Wombats.
Yes.
And it was A Guide to Love, Loss, and Desperation.
Their first album.
Their first album.
All right.
Came out in 2017. 13 songs, yeah.
2007.
Oh, yeah, that's what I meant.
Yep.
2007.
Yep.
13 songs, 42 minutes of music. So, don't worry.
You've written notes this time.
No, I'm just on the Spotify page.
Oh, sorry.
I wasn't sitting there timing it.
Yeah, sorry.
So, I listened to all 42 minutes. I was surprised by how the album started. Because with Kill the Director second, made famous by The Great Inbetweeners...
Mm.
I thought, how are they going to lead into that? And the Tales of Girls, Boys, and Marsupials was not the angle I thought it was going to be.
It's a bit out of the box, isn't it?
It's a bit a cappella.
Yeah.
It's a little bit happy clappers.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I kind of liked it.
It's vibey. It's like it catchy. Is.
Yeah. I liked that a lot. And then obviously, Kill the Director. It's sort of ruined because all I think of is Will.
Yeah.
Walking to the car and then Jay going, your mum's fit. So that's sort of... all my notes for that one. Moving to New York's the best song on the album by Country
banger.
Mile.
Huge banger.
That's arguably the Wombat's best song.
Yep. Okay.
In my opinion.
Yep.
Obviously, we go through. There's a few I didn't like. Didn't like School Uniforms.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really remember the names of the other ones because they're all quite niche names. But Lost in the Post.
Yeah.
Is pretty much the same guitar hooks as Kill the Director. I think. I don't remember. I think it was that one. The same hooks in a different key.
Okay. They're similar. I can see the reflection there.
So I was like, lazy songwriting. Coming from me.
Yeah.
Let's dance to Joy Division.
It's probably their most famous song.
Yeah. And isn't it an ironic name?
Is it ever, Sam?
What's his name? Martin.
Matt Murphy. Yeah.
I'm just close. Backfire at the Disco, I didn't mind either.
Yep.
Patricia the Stripper, I like it purely because of the name. It's
classic. Classic name.
It's funny, isn't it?
Mm.
Overall,
mm.
It's just a fun album, isn't it?
It is a fun album.
It's a fun, boppy sort of indie rock vibe.
Yep.
If you're into British indie rock,
yep.
This one is like a staple, I can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like that,
yep.
You're probably not going to be into it.
I agree with that.
But however,
yep.
I will say, I'm not the biggest Wombats fan. Or indie rock in general, based on my reaction to The Vampire Weekend.
Yeah.
But there is a little bit of something in here for everyone.
Yeah.
Because as I said, Moving to New York is genuinely a song I listen to nearly every day.
It gets, it's enough, it's like punky enough that you want to jump around and have a bit of a pogo to it.
Yeah.
But it's catchy enough that you're like, oh, it's just, it's pop.
It is.
You know, it's
fun, but the guitar is, it's got a bit of grit to it.
It's got a bit of go.
It's got a bit of ticker.
Yeah.
But yeah, I liked it. So overall, if I was rating it on a scale of 1 to 7.8,
yep,
I'd probably rate it about a 4.9.
Nice. Oh, that's
a pass mark.
Yeah. Nice.
Yeah.
And, just one final question for you. Last week, I said, off the back of Towns, I said there was a kind of a comparison I was drawing between the two of them. Did you agree? Did you disagree? You don't have to agree, obviously. It's you know, your opinion.
I think Towns is a little bit more of a raw take on what the Wombats have done.
Yep.
It's certainly a little bit more of an emo take.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But I do see the correlation.
Yeah.
That's about... was there a specific answer?
No, I just wanted to gauge your thoughts.
It's the same universe.
Yeah, in the expanded... It's the same town planet. CU.
It's like a indie pop rock planet.
Yeah.
And they're probably both on them.
Yeah.
Different countries.
Yeah. But different continents maybe even.
Maybe even different continents.
Yeah.
Well, I was thinking like Australia and the US.
Yeah.
Which is still different continents, but it's also different countries. Yeah. So we're both right.
Yeah.
But same planet... It's like right stream, wrong house.
You know? Yeah. I feel you. Nice.
Yeah. Anyway, I brought an album for you.
Yeah, I've got some homework to do.
You're going to hate this.
Oh, yay.
So you couldn't even figure out what it was because there's not... Oh, I mean, it says it there now, but I haven't opened this.
Right.
I bought it in a Dutch vinyl.
Oh, yeah.
In
up in Paddington.
Paddington.
Yep.
Shout out Dutch vinyl.
Yep.
For a reasonable price.
Mm-hmm.
It's Sleep Token's album.
Oh, yeah.
Take Me Back to Eden.
Take Me Back to Eden on the black vinyl.
On the black vinyl.
Wow. Yeah, nice.
If you've seen them. But it's got 12 songs on there.
Chokehold the Summoning Granite. Aqua Regia.
Yeah.
Regia, maybe.
But I give that to you because it's got about 16 different genres. And between... Let me give you the... there's some songs on there that go for 9 minutes.
Okay.
But I think if I was going to give you any homework, I'd say the ones you want to listen to. The Summoning...
Yep. No, I'll do the whole album. But yes, please, highlights.
Yeah, so there's some highlights.
Yeah.
I want to know what you think of The Summoning and Take Me Back to Eden.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe Aqua Regia as well.
Okay. All right. Just for my context, Sleep Token, European band?
British
band.
British. So no one knows their identity.
Ooh.
They're like a metal... Kent. They've fused like metal with... jazzy funk elements.
Ooh.
It's just an experience.
You can't wait to listen to Californication.
It. Yeah, it's a bit different. You can't really describe Sleep Token to anyone, but you'll either love it or hate it is the vibe I've gotten from Sleep Token in general. Because when we put up the video, bands you just can't get around no matter how hard you try. Sleep Token came up
right
a fair bit.
Right. Well, but, no way to find out.
3 million monthly listeners. Their songs have multiple millions of streams. So, well known.
Let's see
interested
how we go.
To see your take.
Absolutely. I'll get back to you on that next week.
Yeah, absolutely. Vinyl Thoughts.
Vinyl Thoughts. Sam, last week I shouted out Catalog Music in the Valley here in Brisbane.
Brisbane.
I ventured that way this week and had a great time down there. Mm. Picked up some real... fun off the beaten track records. They got lots of brizzy bands. I picked up a DZ Death Rays record. I picked up a record from a band called Orphans.
Yep.
Which is a kind of a super group of like, I think it was like one of the Jungle Giants, one of the guys that's now in Confidence Man, one of the guys from like Morning Harvey, all those kind of brizzy bands, maybe one of the guys from DZ as well. And they all brought a song that they had written for each of their bands, but that the bands didn't want, and they put them into a one-off EP.
That's cool.
So each of the songs is a really different style and whatever, but they all play it together. It's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. Picked up the EP of that. And so another shout-out to them. I went to Rocking Horse as well. Always just good old-fashioned time there. I feel like this is going to shouting out record stores.
Yeah.
But I picked up a few records this week that I'm very keen to get my ears around.
I like it.
Yeah.
A lot of my records are on their way.
Mm.
I've pre-ordered a lot of albums.
Yep.
And they're starting to be released,
mm-hmm.
which means that they're not far off.
Ooh.
So I picked up the new Alpha Wolf album on vinyl. That's on its way, Half Living Things. There's a Feature from Ice-T in there.
Ice-T.
Criminal Minds fame. Not Criminal Minds.
SVU.
SVU. Law it's the order. Same shit.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. Anyway, I've got that coming, but I am eager to go to Dutch Vinyl again soon because I think I'm ready to spend.
He's got the cash and he's ready to spend.
I don't have the cash, but I'm ready to spend.